The last universal common ancestor of all life that survived up to modern days has just had its genome reconstructed by an international team of scientists. LUCA, as it is known, turns out to be far more complex than we could have dreamed of, and much, much more ancient. And also, it has some highly specific adaptations that helped it thrive in the primordial oceans. So what was LUCA like, and what are the implications of this discovery for the deep origins of life on Earth and, by extension, on other planets as well? Well, let's find out, shall we? By tracing back genes found in the three main branches of life, scientists from the UK, the Netherlands and Hungary have figured out the foundational genome that all modern life inherited and modified to suit their own needs. These main branches are the bacteria, the archaea, which are a different kind of prokaryotes that, like bacteria, have simple cells, and the eukaryotes. The eukaryotes eventually originated as a fusion of bacterial and archaeal cells into a more complex one. This branch includes everything from single-celled protists to fungi, plants and animals like ourselves. Now, it turns out that LUCA's genome was already very complex, with an estimated whopping 2,657 protein-coding genes. Basically, it was about as complex as an average modern-day bacteria. Now, it's important to take into mind that LUCA was not the earliest life form ever. It was not the first spark of life in a prebiotic primordial soup. It was just the ancestor of all life that still exists today, from bacteria to humans. So it already would have had a lot of evolutionary mileage. You could say it's in essence the earliest modern life form to have ever existed. And naturally, we would expect our last universal common ancestor to have the base level of sophistication of some of the simplest life forms still alive today. One of the most amazing things about this finding is the age of LUCA as being somewhere between 4.1 and 4.3 billion years ago, which is almost about as old as a life form can get. The earliest and most certain direct fossil evidence of life is from about 3.48 billion years ago. The earliest direct evidence of oceans is from about 3.8 billion years ago in the form of sedimentary rocks of the Issua greenstone belt in Greenland. Now, oceans may have existed earlier, but there is a hard lower limit to their formation at about 4.45 billion years ago. That is when Earth was rendered a magma ball again due to the impact with the Mars-sized object that ended up creating the Moon. However, there is indirect evidence in the form of zircon crystals dating back about 4.4 billion years ago, showing that the oceans quickly returned again. This means that once the oceans finally settled on Earth, life had to climb up from the prebiotic chemistry on Earth to a fully geared up microbe, able to deal with all kinds of adversity. And this had to have happened within a few hundred million years. Not that that would be impossible. 100 million years is still a very long time, especially for organisms with a very short generation span. But still pretty amazing. And this has implications for how quickly life could rise to the occasion on any suitable planet in the universe. It looks like a high level of sophistication can be obtained relatively quickly in astronomical terms. So how sophisticated was LUCA already? Let's take a closer look at this. When LUCA lived and thrived, the Earth was a very different place. The atmosphere was not yet oxygenated. It was dominated by hydrogen, methane and ammonia, three reducing gases that also dominate the gas giants in our solar system, and also carbon dioxide. This study confirmed that LUCA likely was able to metabolize carbon dioxide with hydrogen into an organic compound called acetate in a process called acetogenesis. This is based on the inference that LUCA had the genes for the Wood-Ljungdahl metabolic pathway, or WLP for short, which accomplishes this process. Now, there are two possibilities here. LUCA could have lived off organic molecules in its environment, in which case it would have been a so-called organoheterotrophic acetogen, mainly using the WLP for generating energy. Alternatively, LUCA could have synthesized its own organic molecules by purely relying on acetogenesis, in which case it would have been a so-called chemoautotrophic acetogen. As a chemoautotrophic acetogen, LUCA could have lived in many different places, from deep-sea hydrothermal vents to the ocean surface. In both these environments, it could benefit from the rich supply of free hydrogen, heat, and minerals provided under the anoxic conditions with plenty of volcanic activity of the early Earth. Not only that, LUCA would have been part of a rich ecosystem where other organisms could act as methanogens, generating methane that would be split up again by solar irradiation. This would help regulate the levels of free hydrogen, effectively acting as a buffer. This mutually sustaining relationship would have created a stable and balanced ecosystem. It wasn't quite paradise, though, because shortly after, when LUCA first originated, Earth, like its neighboring planets, might have been plagued by the late heavy bombardment of asteroids. This period lasted from about 4.1 to 3.8 billion years ago, and it was earlier thought that it made Earth unsuitable for life again. But now, it looks like life, and especially LUCA, were hardy enough to weather the storm. If it even happened at all, because it's being disputed that it did, or that it was severe enough. But for all we know, LUCA and its descendants may have been the sole survivors of this early onslaught. Okay, well, actually not the sole survivors, because there was a completely different kind of creature around already that also survived. It preyed on LUCA and still does so on its descendants. LUCA was not allowed to metabolize its carbon dioxide and hydrogen in peace. There were dangers lurking in the waters. The inferred presence of an immune defense system showed what it was dealing with. Viruses. LUCA apparently had the genes for a basic CRISPR-Cas system that is still used to seek and destroy recurring threats by remembering their gene sequences. Even as things were going well for our prokaryotic progenitors, it was still a harsh battle for survival, fending off these parasites. And this also raises a few interesting questions on the origin of viruses, which merely are short strands of genome packaged in protein. There are two main theories on that. The reduction hypothesis suggests that viruses could be descendants of earlier prokaryotes that lost all their cellular structures and even the capability to reproduce on their own. The virus first hypothesis posits that viruses might have originated from self-replicating molecules that existed before cellular life and later adapted to exploit early prokaryotes. The latter is perhaps the most fascinating, with viruses then being the final remnants of these first steps towards life. The exciting prospect on these latest findings in LUCA is that it opens up to going even further back in time, reconstructing the steps that led up to it, perhaps even any pre-cellular stages. In any case, all things considered, it looks like life was already very recognizable as life as we know it from the very beginning, that is, within a couple of 100 million years. That has some deep and intriguing implications for life in general and in the cosmos. So can life really quickly form from prebiotic chemistry on a planet with just the right conditions? If this is so, then almost certainly the same would have happened to our neighboring planets, Mars and Venus, and perhaps even the ice shell moon circling around our giant planets. Think about that for a moment. Less than 4 billion years ago, we may have had three planets in our solar system that hosted life under almost identical conditions. Back then, these were truly sibling planets, very similar cradles for very similar baby biospheres. But only one of those babies made it to maturity, unfortunately. There is an alternative and more controversial idea that we should be careful about, but cannot quite dismiss, and that is panspermia. The problem with panspermia is that, on first glance, it moves the buck, so to speak. Or in other words, it doesn't really solve the question on how life can form from planetary chemistry. On the other hand, if it actually is statistically hard to get the spark of life going, then moving it to a cosmic scale may give it more leeway. If we eventually find life on our neighboring planets or moons, that could either confirm or dispel panspermia. Life out there could either bear the similarities that point to a common origins, or don't. So what do you think? Could LUCA have evolved on Earth within a couple of million years? Might there have been and still be relatives active on Mars and Venus? Could there also be simple life under the shells of ice moons in our solar system? Or were there some specific circumstances on Earth that made it unique in facilitating life? Let us know in the comments. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and maybe even a sub if you haven't already. Thanks for sticking around. Until next time, stay sharp and stay evolved.